Now we get to the last and most important part of this short review of math, word problems. This is where math becomes real. In this course, we're interested in using math as a tool to help us learn new things about astronomical objects, and that means we'll be solving word problems that relate the math to the astronomy. The mathematical tool we'll be using to solve word problems is algebra. Since not everyone has seen much algebra, let's go over how we'll be using it in this course.
The key here is something called an algebraic formula. A formula is just a shorthand way of saying how one quantity relates to another. Here's an example. D equals VT. That means the distance an object travels equals the average velocity multiplied by the travel time. Both of these say exactly the same thing. Let's take it in parts. D is the distance an object travels, V is the average velocity, and T is the time. If you haven't had any algebra before, notice that there's no time sign written between the V and the T. Whenever you have two symbols like this side by side, it's assumed that they're multiplied. Now, since both statements say the same thing, which one would you rather have to write out? The long one or the short one?
The power of using algebraic formulas is that it makes it easy to see at a glance how all of the pieces are connected, and you know it's true no matter what specific values you put in for the symbols.
Let's take a look at how we solve word problems in this class. I'm going to run through a cookbook approach for solving these. If you already have enough experience that you're comfortable tackling questions like this, you should go ahead and use whatever method you're used to. But if you're uncertain about what to do, you can use this as a guideline to help you work through these problems. So step one is reading the problem. This is one of those obvious things that a lot of students never really do. They just look at a few key words and hope they can go from there. But you really should read through the whole thing and ask yourself two questions. What information is the question asking for? And what information does the problem give you to get you there? Once you know those two things, you can move on to the next step. In step two, you need to think about what the problem means. In this class, we won't be asking you math problems on random topics. They will always be about the astronomy we're studying. That means that you should already have an idea of the kinds of values we're talking about, and at least a rough idea of the kind of answer you're expecting. Large mass measured in kilograms? Small distance measured in astronomical units? Convincing yourself to write down this rough guess on paper is, for some students, psychologically harder than actually making the calculation. But that's because you may rarely have been asked to write down and turn in rough estimates. And that's exactly what we're asking you to do here. Some valid predictions might be, this planet is more massive than the Earth, or this planet's mass is larger than the masses of other planets in this problem.
Step three is writing down the formula. In other words, see what algebraic formula relates the things you know to the things you're trying to learn. Step four is looking up other information. Often you'll need to go out and find something like the speed of light, or the mass of a planet or star, or some other important number that has to go into the problem. So you should do that at this point. In step five, you write down the formula again, but this time you put in all of the numerical values and their units. The units are important because of step six, checking the units and converting. We'll look more closely at unit conversions a little later, but this is where you would do it. Step seven is where you actually solve the problem. Just do whatever the algebraic formula says to do. If it says multiply speed by time, you do that. Once again, make sure you keep track of the units in every line.
Finally, step eight is where you compare your answer and make sure it makes sense. This is a really important step, And it's often what separates the folks who do well at this from the folks who don't. You should always look to see if your answer fits with what's being asked. I call this doing a sanity check. You want to be able to recognize if your answer is nuts, even if you're not sure what went wrong. This is also where you compare your answer to your prediction. If your answer makes sense and agrees with your prediction, you're probably on the right track. If the answer doesn't agree with a prediction, then you'll need to decide if your prediction is wrong, in which case it's okay to say so and explain why, or if you've got a mistake in your calculation. We'll come back to what to do with a calculation problem later in the lecture. Notice the pattern highlighted in steps 2, 3, and 8. Predict, calculate, compare. These are the steps that make us use the math to learn about astronomy. So calculations on the homework and exams have a similar pattern. You won't get full credit for just the calculation. Conversely, and this should be a comfort to folks who find math a little scary, good predictions and comparisons can earn you partial credit, even if your calculation isn't perfect. Okay, those are the steps. Now let's look at an example and see how they work.
Here's a simple word problem we can try. There's a spacecraft going to the moon at 8,000 kilometers per hour. If it takes 48 hours to get there, how far away is the moon? Step one is read the question. You should notice two key things here. It wants you to find the distance, and it's told you the speed and the time. Step two is your prediction. On most assignments, we'll give you something more specific to predict. But here we can certainly say that the moon is a long distance away, so we should get a lot of kilometers. If we get an answer that's only 1 or 2 kilometers, we'll know that something is wrong. Step three is writing down the relevant formula. We should know this one by now. D equals VT. Distance is velocity times time. In other words, if we know the speed and the time, we can find the distance. Step four is asking if you need to look anything up, but it doesn't look like it here. We've got all the information we need to solve this one.
Step five is writing down the equation again. So we just write it out in full. D equals 8,000 kilometers per hour times 48 hours. Notice that it doesn't say D equals 8,000 times 48. You've got to keep those units in there. The time is 48 hours, not just 48, so you should write it all down, 48 hours.
Step six is checking to see if you need to do a unit conversion. We'll look at these more closely in a couple of slides, but for now we can say that no conversion needed. Time units come up twice, but they're both the same, hours, so we're fine here.
Now we solve the problem. Since all we're doing is multiplying, we can group the numbers together and then group the units together. 8,000 times 48 is 384,000. We also have kilometers divided by hours in the speed and then multiplied by hours from the time. Since you're both dividing and multiplying by hours, they cancel out and the only unit left is kilometers. So the distance is 384,000 kilometers.
Finally, we do a comparison. As we expected, the distance was a lot of kilometers, so that looks right. Also, the units are distance units, kilometers. If we'd gotten kilometers per hour, or hours, or something else, we'd know that there was a mistake somewhere because we're not getting a distance. In the calculation part of the assignment, steps 3 through 7, you're expected to show your work. However, you don't have to show everything that's listed here in what you turn in. You certainly can include all of this if you'd like, but on the next slide, I'll show you what the bare minimum is to count as showing your work. You certainly need to have the formula, D equals VT. You also need to show the formula with all the values listed in it. If there was a unit conversion, you would have shown that, though in this case we didn't have to. Finally, you should show the answer with its units. That's the minimum needed to show your work in one of these questions.